I've always been an insatiably curious person and a total science geek. I was the type of kid who had to discover where all the Christmas presents were hidden and deftly unwrap them and rewrap all of them without my parents knowing. Discovering the unknown before anyone else, especially my siblings, brought me great joy. That curiosity, drive, and perseverance has served me well in my career as a neuroscientist. All that has resulted in me having the best job in the world. I get to ask why for a living and solve the puzzles of how to overcome the often devastating consequences of diseases such as multiple sclerosis or peripheral nerve injuries. Our nervous system is amazing. It allows us to breathe, feel, solve puzzles, and move at will. It includes our brain and spinal cord and all the nerves out in our periphery. But when we experience trauma, such as peripheral nerve injury, or are diagnosed with an inflammatory neurodegenerative disease, such as multiple sclerosis, we can lose function and experience debilitating pain. My own journey of hope started as a research technician and then doctoral student at McGill in Montreal, and has taken me to a province where the prevalence of MS is one of the highest in the world. Who here has been touched by MS? My best friend has MS. Today, I direct a research center focused on MS and other neurological disorders. The curiosity that bloomed as a young child is now being put to good use as I set out to determine new treatments to fight MS and nerve injury. A healthy nervous system is critical for our overall health and well-being. When our nerves are injured, it creates many challenges that often lead to loss of function and debilitating pain. Imagine if you just had a motorcycle accident and suffered extensive damage to the nerves in your shoulder area. Even with gifted surgical repair, the axons, the long cables extending from the nerve cells that collectively form the nerve, can take a long time to regrow back to the muscles in the arm and eventually to the hand. The regenerating nerves typically grow at only 1 millimeter per day. So it can take over 800 days to reach the hand again, and even longer if you're taller. And there's still no guarantee that the nerves will reconnect properly. What if we could accelerate a nerve's repair process and get more axons regenerating? That is the question my research is looking to answer. Now, in the case of multiple sclerosis, which is a chronic inflammatory demyelinating disease, there are lots of challenges. And this can differ depending on the stage of the disease. Myelin, shown in beige on this nerve cell, is a protective insulating substance wrapped around the long cable-like axons that allows us to move electrical signals down the axon. In MS, the myelin is attacked. The ensuing loss of myelin essentially short circuits the signal and leaves the axon naked. In this state, it is more prone to damage and degeneration, which as the disease progresses, contributes to loss of function that may be permanent. This is because our repair capacity in MS diminishes as the disease progresses. So we're racing against the clock, the need for effective and timely repair strategies that may alter disease course and prevent degeneration is crucial. One of my first revelations came from experiments in the early 1980s with my PhD supervisor, renowned neuroscientist and neurosurgeon at the Montreal General Hospital, Dr. Peter Richardson. The experiment showed us that our limited ability to repair axons in our brain and spinal cord could be greatly enhanced if we delivered two back-to-back injuries to nerve cells. I know, it sounds contradictory, but it worked. The first injury turned on repair programs so that when the nerve cell was injured again a week later, it was already primed for repair. It then repaired at three times the speed and many more injured axons regenerated. But injuring a nerve cell twice usually isn't clinically advised. We want it to induce this type of intrinsic enhanced repair without another injury. We found that direct nerve stimulation at the time of surgical nerve repair was highly effective. Making injured nerve cells fire for the right duration results in them turning on a heightened and accelerated nerve repair state. Direct nerve stimulation was also highly effective at repairing regions where we deliberately destroyed the myelin to see if it would repair. So what does this all mean exactly? I'll give you an analogy. Exercise is a prime example of how stimulating nerve cells can be beneficial. Exercise makes nerve cells fire, which can help turn on repair programs. This can lead to a stronger heart and stronger muscles. Here are two fine examples of doing this in the wintertime. That's my husband and our son in the photo. They're getting a great workout on our kick sleds or running 6 kilometers on the riverbank trails at minus 40 Celsius. Yuck. Our direct nerve stimulation studies overall showed us that deliberately making nerve cells fire can really benefit the repair of a damaged nervous system. This was a revolutionizing concept for promoting nervous system repair, but it requires the placement of electrodes on the injured nerve, which is invasive and not a very practical solution for people with MS, where the attacks can occur anywhere in the brain and spinal cord. The question then became, could we find a non-invasive therapy that resulted in nerve cells firing? What we settled on was an amazing emerging therapy called acute intermittent hypoxia, otherwise known as AIH, a treatment that has tremendous potential to enhance repair through breathing. Can I get you all just to take a breath with me? Breathe in, breathe out. Imagine a therapy as simple as that. It doesn't get more simple. This non-invasive therapy is something that we do thousands of times a day. AIH involves breathing a short number of cycles of normal air at 21% oxygen, alternating with air at about half the level of oxygen, 10 to 11% oxygen. It's like alternating breathing between air in Saskatoon and air at the base camp at Mount Everest. But instead of quickly teleporting you to Everest, we use a machine that produces air with lower levels of oxygen that you can breathe through a mask. The key is to keep the number of cycles low and the exposure to the lower levels of oxygen short. This process induces a level of beneficial stress, much like what happens with aerobic exercise, and makes nerve cells fire. Until recently, AIH treatment has been largely used in research by others examining its impact on plasticity, which means whether or not it was enhancing the circuitry and function that remained in people or animal models with incomplete high cervical long-term spinal cord injury. We know that AIH could increase the distance the subjects walked and could improve hand function. Importantly, in these and other clinical studies, no harmful impacts were observed. But when I examined rodent tissue exposed to AIH treatment, I saw many repair molecules being produced. I thought, could AIH be effective as a therapy to repair the nervous system? Could it be as effective as electrical nerve stimulation? So we directly compared electrical nerve stimulation to AIH treatment following surgical repair. We saw that they both greatly enhanced nerve repair in a similar manner in our rodent model of nerve injury, including remyelination of the regenerated axons. To give you an example of how AIH promotes nerve cell growth in repair states, we isolated and cultured nerve cells two ways. Under normoxia, these are cells grown in normal air or nerve cells that were given on the other side, one treatment of AIH, and then we waited one more day. And we looked at the difference between the treatments, whether or not it affected their ability to grow an axon. We were delighted with the results, as you can see. We saw AIH enhance the growth potential of the thin white axon-like protrusions extending from the small round nerve cells. Now, knowing that AIH also improved remyelination of regenerating axons in our other study, we knew we had to start trying it on mice with a progressive MS-like disease. And so we treated these mice with once daily AIH treatment for a week, starting at a point when they had severe inflammation, coupled with myelin loss and an inability to walk using their hind limbs. And then we waited one more week. What we saw was remarkable and got us very excited. When my graduate student first showed me the results under the microscope, I got chills thinking what this might mean. We saw that mice with progressive MS-like disease treated with normal air had massive levels of inflammation in the affected spinal cord regions. And in those inflammatory regions, there was an extensive loss of myelin. In contrast, mice receiving 1 week of daily AIH treatment had 80% less inflammation. Indeed, every single parameter of repair we examined was significantly improved. This included walking ability, indicators that the axons were back in a protected state, improved remyelination, and the 20% of inflammation that remained was driven from a pro-inflammatory state to a pro-repair state. This was one of the most robust repair responses I have seen in all my years of research. It's amazing that breathing air with changing oxygen levels can have such big effects. So where does all this newly discovered non-invasive AIH-induced repair potential take us? To a very exciting future, where we will begin conducting clinical trials, exploring its potential to improve peripheral nerve repair, and to examine its safety and efficacy in MS patients. For those of you who raised your hands when I asked if you had someone in your life or you yourself were afflicted with MS, just think, this work could greatly enhance the quality of life for them. It brings me great joy in knowing that people could be so positively affected by my life's work. My quest for an answer to nerve repair and MS has been like a 3,000-piece jigsaw puzzle. At the beginning of the quest, it was very hard to get the picture started. But as I gathered together my team of highly intelligent and inquisitive people and collaborators who are amongst the best in the world at what they do, we were able to make tremendous progress. As we are getting down to those last 100 pieces, we are finishing the puzzle at an accelerated rate. We're close to seeing the entire picture. To think, all this began with a curious little girl and her unwavering quest to discover the unknown and ask why. Thank you very much.